Greetings everyone, Quantum Unicorn here. Welcome to my channel. If you haven't been following along with the video so far, then I have a link in the description section below that links to where you can download all the data files so you can follow along with this, okay? And please subscribe to my channel, like the video, and click the bell icon on to receive the latest updates. Thank you. In this video, we will examine frequency and relative frequency of observed outcomes and introduce the concept of distribution. To recap, we will use a dice game from the previous video as an example. As you can see, each die has a 1/6 probability of rolling any single number, 1 through 6. But the sum of two dice will form the probability distribution. If we roll the dice 10,000 times, as you can see here, 7 is the most common outcome. Two and 12, on the other hand, are far less likely. Okay, so here I'm going to introduce the concept of normal distribution. Normal distribution is a probability distribution that is symmetric about the mean, showing that data near the mean are more frequent in occurrence than data far from the mean. The normal distribution is the most common type of distribution assumed in technical stock market analysis and in other types of statistical analysis. The standard normal distribution has two parameters, the mean, which is the average value, and the standard deviation, which is a statistical measurement that looks how far a group of numbers is from the mean. Put simply, standard deviation measures how far apart numbers are in a data set. Standard deviation is a basic mathematical concept that has an important place in various parts of the financial sector, from accounting to economics to investing. It measures the variability of figures within a data set, using the mean of a certain group of numbers. It is important to help determine volatility and the distribution of returns. The assumption of a normal distribution is applied to asset prices as well as price action. Traders may plot price points over time to fit recent price action into a normal distribution. The further price action moves from the mean, in this case, the greater the likelihood that an asset is being over or undervalued. Traders can use the standard deviation to suggest potential trades. Okay, let's get back to our dice game. Actually, as we discussed before, the sum of the dice is a random variable. Here, let's obtain 50 realized outcomes of the sum by rolling the dice 50 times. Let's now calculate the frequency in the collection of the outcomes. The data frame method value counts is particularly useful in the regard, as it outputs a pandas series with a single column. Put simply, it returns a series containing counts of unique values. The resulting object will be in descending order so that the first element is the most frequent occurring element. So the index of the series is a list of different outcomes, and the value column represents the frequency of each outcome. Sorting this series according to the index using sort index allows for easy analysis. Sort index will sort series by index labels. It returns a new series sorted by label if in-place argument is false. Otherwise, it updates the original series and returns none. For example, the first row of our output indicates that the frequency for an outcome of 2 is equal to 1. Okay, next. We can present the frequency data using a bar chart, which shows how the frequency changes as the number of trials increases. To compare the frequency of different trials, we must convert frequency into relative frequency. Basically, relative frequency is how often something happens divided by all outcomes. Here, we have tossed the dice 50 times, so the relative frequency is equal to number of frequency of each outcome divided by the total number of trials, which is 50 in our case. This transformation does not affect the shape of the bar chart, but alters the scale of the y-axis. Now, let me roll the dice 100 times and see how the bar chart of the frequency for the outcomes looks like. Here. Then I'm going to do an experiment here. I will increase the number of trials gradually. Say I will try 400 trials and 800 trials. And 10,000 trials respectively. And obviously, as the number of trials increases, the bar chart converges towards a limit and the relative frequency becomes more and more stable. Here, I'm going to introduce the concept of central limit theorem. In probability theory, the central limit theorem, aka CLT, states that the n variable approximate a normal distribution as the sample size becomes larger, assuming that all samples are identical in size and regardless of the population's actual distribution shape. Put another way, CLT is a statistical premise that, given a sufficiently large sample size from a population with a finite level of variance, the mean of all sampled variables from the same population will be approximately equal to the mean of the whole population. Furthermore, these samples approximate a normal distribution, with their variances being approximately equal to the variance of the population as the sample size gets larger, according to the law of large numbers. And variance is the average of each point from the mean, while standard deviation measures the square root of the variance. Okay. Now, the distribution of a random variable is a table that contains two sets of values. One set lists the different values of the outcome, and the other set lists the probability for each value. We can use Python to compute all probabilities for X. The X distribution is the distribution table we built. However, this distribution table does not immediately reveal the shape of the outcome. Typically, the mean and the variance are two characteristics of the distribution of random variables. The mean of a random variable is also known as the expectation. Here you can see the general formula for the mean and variance of a discrete random variable. Xi represents the only possible outcome, while Pi represents the probability for this outcome. The mean is the average of all outcomes weighted by probabilities. The variance describes the variation of outcome. Here, let's use the Python code to compute the mean and variance given a distribution table. Here we can see the results. The first number is mean and the second number is variance. Okay, well, enough discussion of distribution for discrete random variables. Now let's explore some basics of the distribution for continuous random variables. We will compute the probability for continuous random variables starting with the simplest continuous random variable, which has a uniform distribution. This kind of variable takes possible values with equal chance in a certain range. Here is a distribution graph for a uniform random variable that takes values between 0 and 100 with equal chance. The height of the red line is not a probability. Rather, it represents the value of a density function, which is used to compute the probability for continuous random variables. The area under the density curve is the probability, and the entire area between 0 and 100 is equal to 1, because this random variable can only take a value in this range. To compute the probability for X taking a value between 20 and 60, we need to obtain the area with the pink color. In summary, for discrete random variables, we can easily find the probability by checking the table of distribution. However, it is more complicated in the case of continuous random variable. The probability is the area under the probability density function curve, which can take any shape. It is important to note that the PDF, or probability density function, should not be confused with the probability. Returning to the field of finance, we require continuous random variables since the distribution of stock return is continuous. It is impossible to directly observe the actual distribution of stock return as opposed to the dice game. Nevertheless, are there any reliable distributions that can adequately describe the data return? Sure. In the next video, we will delve into this matter and demonstrate the application of the normal random variable, which is the most widely used continuous random variable, to approximate the distribution of stock return. How exciting! Well, that's all for today. Congratulations on finishing this tutorial. Please subscribe to my channel, like the video, and share it out. If you have any inquiries or concerns, feel free to reach out and leave a comment. Well, thank you for your time, and I look forward to connecting with you soon. Goodbye.